Will you be my light when I cannot see? And when I can't take another step, Lord, would you carry me? And when I've lost my fight, will you be my strength? Will you set me a table in the presence of my enemies? I shall not want. I shall not want. Oh, my soul's got a shepherd in the valley, and I shall not want. I shall not want. I shall not want. 'Cause my cup's running over, and I shall not want. And I will lift my eyes to where my help comes from. And I won't be afraid of the shadow, 'cause I've seen the sun. No, I will not stop when the way gets hard. 'Cause the green only grows in the valley, and that's where you are. Say, I shall not walk. No, no, I shall not walk. Hey, oh, my soul's got a shepherd in the valley. I shall not walk. Oh, I shall not walk. Oh, I shall not walk. 'Cause my cup's running over.
'Cause my cup's running over.
Show you something that I hope and pray that will help you. Look with me to Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 through 6. Now, I don't know how fired up we're going to get today, but I am going to help you if you will allow me. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets, to be honored by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received the reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room. Most translations say, go into your closet, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you openly. Now, I just want to pause for a moment and share with you that this scripture is not teaching that our giving should be entirely done in secret. Because we have to look at the whole context of the Word of God. If we believe that this scripture is promoting that we should give everything in secret, then we cannot pray at church either. Because this scripture is, if you're going down and read it, it's talking about three things. It's talking about giving, praying, and fasting. And I just read to you that when you pray, do not pray in the synagogues like the hypocrites do. Well, I've been praying ever since I got here this morning. Matter of fact, prayer started at 9:30 this morning for some of us. So we understand that this scripture, you can't just say, well, I'm going to believe one part of it, but I'm not going to believe the other part. You can't pick and choose what you're going to believe and what you're going to take from the Word of God. I challenge you, if you're taking down some notes, write this down. There's a guy by the name of Randy Acorn. And Randy has done a great study on these scriptures. I'm just going to share a little bit with you this morning. In Matthew 6, 2 and 4, Jesus was not establishing a principle that nobody should ever know what someone gives. Then the members of, if that's true, the members of the early church violated in Acts chapter 4, verse 36 and 37. So right at the beginning of the church, if that is true, the early church blew it already, which we know is not true. And I hope you write these down because I don't have time to go into all of this. There's no way around the list of names of donors to the tabernacle that tells you exactly how much the leaders of Israel gave to build the temple. It says the people rejoiced at the willing responses of their leaders, for they had given freely and wholeheartedly to the Lord. 1 Chronicles chapter 29 verse 9 talks about how that the leaders of the congregation stepped up and said, we're going to give so much. You're going to read that. They gave gold, they gave silver, right out in front of everybody. Philemon, chapter 1, verse 7, refers to Philemon's generous giving by name. 2 Corinthians, chapter 8, verse 2 and 3, it's definitely a reference to the Macedonians' generous giving. As we seek to understand the meaning of Matthew 6, 2 through 4, we must consider the full counsel of scriptures. Stop and think about it. I don't want to make it a funny thing or whatever, but don't let your left hand know what your right hand's doing. Neither one of my hands know anything. Unless my brain tells them. My brain is telling my thumb to move. If my brain did not, how can my left hand know anything about my right hand or vice versa? Through the years, people have taken that scripture, just like my grandfather and the elders of old took the scripture about cutting down a tree and decorating it. It's the same concept. Good, honest people, but just didn't have a lot of knowledge of what they were talking about. In 2010, a survey was taken of America, and America had 73% favorable viewing of the church, the body of Christ. Bypassing all denominations, bypassing all religions, just the body of Christ. 73% view, good view of the church. 5 years later, 2015, that figure was down to 55%. 2010, 73% favorable viewing of the church. 5 years later, 2015, 55%. I wonder where it's at today. Everybody in this room knows people that don't like the church. I'm not talking about Cornerstone. Everybody loves Cornerstone. I'm just joking. But listen, where would that figure be at today? Because all we ever hear about the church is negative. I'm not a Hillsong person, I don't guess. I don't know who they are. Besides hearing Alan talk about them, different ones talk about them, and Tina wanting to go to a conference or whatever. I mean, I know that much, but you know what? I know that in the last year, they've had two pastors that's committed adultery. How do I know that? I don't know them. Because I've read about it all over Facebook. I don't know how many times. I've read about it on social media. I've seen it on news. I've seen it on everything. Nobody ever talked about those two guys when they were doing good. I mean, you see what I'm saying? They both preached for years, saved all kinds of people through their preaching and praying and counseling, whatever. And we never even heard of them. Didn't even know their names. Let a preacher mess up, everybody knows about it. Let a youth worker mess up, everybody knows about it. Let a church secretary steal money, everybody knows about it. But you want us to sit inside this building and never talk about the goodness of God or the greatness of God outside of this building. The people inside of the building don't need it. We already believe it. It's the people on the outside that needs to know that there's a church that still loves God, that still does the right thing, that is trying to bless their community. I've got a whole lot. I'm not going to go into it, but listen. You know what I have personally found out? Now, this is just me. I'm not saying this to anybody else. I'm not accusing nobody. I could care less. It don't matter. You know what I found out through the years, the 35 years that I've been preaching here, 40 years of ministry? What I have found out, people, that's their favorite verse of scripture in the whole Bible. Don't let your right hand know what your left hand's doing or vice versa. It's because they don't give. And they don't want nobody to know they don't give. We call them hypocrites. I'm not so naive to know that when we went out on Friday to give away $11,000+, that people were going to be like the old Wild West, pull out both six shooters. I knew that was coming. And it came. But it's okay. The people that we gave to, one mother who said, my children are out of school to Tuesday, and I didn't know how I was going to feed them. But now I got $100 to feed my kids. One lady told me, she said, I didn't know what I was going to do with my kids being out of school. We didn't have nowhere to go or nothing to do, and now I'm going to be able to take them out to the park and buy them an ice cream and give them something. Listen, just because you're blessed, don't forget about people who are still living the way you used to live before God changed the way you are today. We've all been there. I've been there. You've been there. We've all been there. But don't take the blessings of God and allow it to become a curse to you. The bottom line is this. We did not have to do it. We did it for one reason. God said to do it. And when God says to do it, we're going to do it. We really don't care who likes it, who don't like it. I'm thankful that we're a blessed house. I said we're a blessed house. We are a blessed, and we are blessed to be a blessing. God blesses you for you to be a blessing. God blesses this house for this house to be a blessing. Not for you to hoard it up to yourself. When God God increases your living, you should increase your giving. We just did 4:11. And when God spoke to me, I'm going to be honest with you. I didn't just jump up and down and say, woohoo! Yeah! That's going to be fun! When God first spoke it into my spirit, it scared me to death. Because I'm thinking, we just did a lot. I want to say, slow down, Lord. Don't slow down your blessings. Keep them coming. Just slow down the request. But you know what? God knows. God knows. I think it'd be cool if we could give away 10,000 every Friday. That'd be fun. In the last 12 months, it's pretty cool because you that go to Cornerstone, we do everything. We talk about how we try our best to do everything white, black, and brown. And platform staff, pastoral staff, Sunday school, parking lot, everything. In the last 12 months, a Caucasian family and a black family had contacted me to inform me that they had paid off their house. And I thought, well, that's cool. In my thinking, and I said this to the Lord, Lord, we need a Latino family to pay off their house. I didn't even know they were anywhere close. So now we have a white family, a black family, a Latino family in the last 12 months that's paid off their house. I had a family tell me this week, they're already making plans. They're going to travel over to Nashville, Tennessee and ring the bell or do something at Dave Ramsey's place because they're getting ready to go debt free. In their early 40s. That's called the blessings of the Lord. That's called the favor of God. By year's end, Tina and I will pay off our home. Amen. Listen, to God be the glory for all of these folks. That is not for you to sit there and get discouraged and get mad. That's to build your faith, to tell you, you can be the next one. You can pay off your home 10 years ahead of time, 20 years ahead of time. There's some things you can do to position yourself. And that's the people that receive the blessings of the Lord. Let me just give you one thing that'll help you. And we'll move on. If your payment's $1,000 a month, number one, you ought to give God praise. Praise God. Rent's more expensive than that. But listen, pay an extra payment every year. And you'll take a 30-year mortgage down to 18 years. Did you hear what I just said? You would take a 30-year mortgage down to 18 years just by paying one extra payment a year. The word interest in the original Greek is a bite of the serpent. If you pay $250,000 for a house, the chances are you're going to pay $600,000 or $700,000 for that house. Right. By the time you pay, you can help yourself. See, when I got the text from Antonio, it said, thank you for your teachings. Your teachings have changed our lives. But it will only change the lives of those that obey. Someone can teach you all day long, and it falls on stony ground. falls on bad soil. It's only when the seed is planted in good soil is it going to bring forth a harvest.
This is not the end. And when you call my